This is an educational and entertainment video documenting the restoration of a vintage AC-powered stereophonic tape recorder. It is being restored by a qualified person who knows how to work safely with live electrical equipment. Electricity can kill. ClydeSight Productions is not responsible for anything you do to yourself or your own tape recorder as a result of watching this video.
Transport mechanism of the 1288 and the frame, which is here, are actually two separate pieces, and they bolt together. The wiring is handled by jumpers, and for example, here are some head wires here, and they jump to the amplifier board. I've taken them out and labeled them very, very carefully. So this deck actually comes out of the frame. I've just got it sitting here loosely to show you how it is a two-piece unit. So if I lift this up, you can see the whole thing comes out. When I took the transport out of the machine and flipped it over, I could see a burn mark on the backside of the transport. It didn't harm the transport because obviously it's made of metal, but anytime you see a burn mark, that's cause for concern. And this was the source of the burn mark. It was arcing caused by a bad connection between a ceramic disc capacitor and the leg of the tube socket here. Now, this tube socket is the 6T9 tube for the right channel, and that was putting out 285 volts. So when this connection failed, the voltage was arcing and causing quite a bit of damage here to the circuit board. In fact, it burned right through the circuit board. So what I had to do was I had to cut the traces here on the circuit board. You can see in white where I took the copper out, because everything had carbonized underneath, and that creates a dielectric. Consequently, the system will short. So I cut the traces. You can see the green here where they're still good. You can see the white where it has all been cut. I then filled the space, after cleaning it as much as possible of the carbon, with epoxy, and then tested the capacitor very carefully. It was not damaged except for the burn on the lead, and the lead was pretty solid. So I cleaned the lead, and then I resoldered it very carefully to the pad, and then made a mechanical jump across to the actual pin on the tube to prevent any further problems. Now, because I had cut these traces in the circuit board, I had to put in a wire jump from one terminal to another terminal, and the same thing over here, to compensate for the cut of the trace. This is a hybrid amplifier. It uses two 6T9 tubes for the power amplifier. It uses tubes for the rectifier and the bias, but the preamplifier is handled by transistors, and here is one of them. There are four transistors in here, and one of the things that's interesting is that Wollensak mounted them on actual sockets so they could be pulled out of the sockets and put back in. Now, I haven't done that with these because any kind of movement could disturb something. We don't want to disturb it at all if possible. Now, there are two transformers here. These are the audio output transformers, and it's only a 3-watt system, but these are pretty big transformers. These are the sockets for the 6T9 amplifier tubes, and then the rest of them are for the rectifier tubes and the bias oscillator and so on. Now, one of the problems that this machine had is that this capacitor here, this can capacitor, while it looks perfectly good, it was actually, it has blown, and I can tell because if I put my fingers on the side of it, I can feel a bulge in the case. This is another power capacitor that probably should be replaced. In fact, I'm going to replace all of the capacitors in the system. There are only 14 capacitors, so it's not that big a deal to do that. There is, however, a slight problem with replacing these capacitors. These capacitors were made by Mallory, and I've got them desoldered so I can lift them out. And they are what are called twist-lock capacitors, which means that the can has a tab, three tabs on it, and acts as the negative, and then there are two positives that plug into the circuit board. So, ideally, you want to replace this with another unit of the same kind. Problem is, Mallory is no longer making these, especially in this configuration. This one's 40 microfarads on, it's a dual can, two 40 microfarad terminals here, and a common ground. Finding a replacement for that proved to be impossible, so I had to buy another capacitor, and believe it or not, this was the closest I could get to it. And it's completely different. It obviously is not going to fit on the board this way, so I've come up with another way of mounting it. Now, this type of capacitor has solder lugs on it. The capacitor case itself does not contain the ground. It is separate and is on this pin here. And then here are the two positives for the 40 microfarad capacitors that are contained within the can. The rest of the capacitors are all easily replaced because they're just common circuit board type capacitors. It's just these can capacitors could be a real problem. Now, before I continue with this, I would also like to give a shout out to John Costas of Medford Electronics, whom I have been talking to about this machine, and he has been guiding me on the electronics. He works on old vintage equipment, audiovisual equipment, modern audiovisual equipment. He runs Medford Electronics in Medford, Massachusetts. He's an expert at what he does, and he's been very helpful in giving me advice about how to deal with all the problems that I'm running into in this amplifier board. Part of what Wollensak did to help protect people, because you would have to get in here to change the tubes, was they made an interlocking plate. And as you can see here, there's a socket that goes into two pins here and here. There are two record play switches on the machine. This is the one for the right channel. The one for the left channel is out of camera range. And they're very easily accessible, obviously, for cleaning. Because they're so open and exposed, however, they are subject to corrosion. After checking and making sure everything is exactly right three or four times, I replaced all the little capacitors in the machine. These are little 10 microfarad capacitors. This is 100 microfarad. And there are other capacitors on the board here. So these are replacing the old capacitors, some of which I could see when I removed them had dielectric on the bottoms of them, so I could tell that they were leaking and they had gone bad. So these caps are now replaced, and I was extra, extra careful. They put a little plus mark on the board here to show where the positive side of the electrolytic cap goes. So these caps are marked with the negative side, which meant thinking around that. So that's why I checked several times before I put it in to make sure that all the polarity is correct. And so these caps, there's 1, 2, 3, 4 here, and there's 3 here, 1, 2, 3, and then up above here we see 1, 2, 3. Now, there was an interesting trick that, for some reason, Wollensak pulled. I don't know why they did this. But on these caps, the positive side is here, here, and here. So you would think, since this set of caps is a mirror of that for the second channel, it would be the same. But no. The positive is on this side, the positive is on this side. But on this last cap, the positive is over on the opposite side. So I checked very carefully, I checked against the schematics, I checked against the manual, and that was what they had. Where in the world am I going to put this cap and the second cap that goes anywhere? Well, it turns out that this space is completely empty. This is not being used at all. This is the volume control and tone control for the right channel and the meter. And this is the meter control strip. And this is the little pilot light that goes on and off when you turn the machine on. So this space, there is plenty of space here. So the cap, this cap could sit here just like that and then be wired over into the board to where it goes. So what I did was I came up with this rather interesting solution to isolate this cap electrically so that only these leads are giving power, nothing else is doing that. So first of all, I wrapped the cap with clear tape and several layers of it, and also it has this electrical tape, and that's there for a reason. In order to sit the cap and mount it into the board, I could epoxy it in, I suppose, but then how could I ever get it out again? So that was no good. So I needed to come up with some kind of thing for this to sit in. And the answer was this little plastic cup, which looks kind of like a mess. And the reason why it looks like a mess is because it's actually a tea candle. And I simply removed the wax from the tea candle. I'd actually used the tea candle anyway. And so I drilled a hole in the bottom of it, and there's a small screw that goes in here, and that bolts to the chassis. And I also put a rubber O-ring here, and I insulated the bottom of the cap with clear tape so that when it sits together like that, it is electrically insulated from the case. It may not be necessary to do that, but I just want to play safe because it is a lot of voltage that's going through there. Now, what about the other end of the cap? Well, if you remember a video I did on the Newcomb cassette tape recorder, I did an editorial about the way we lost the drug wars when prescription drugs became advertised and are being pushed so heavily in the medical industry and among consumers. And I have to take a lot of heart medicine, which comes in orange pill containers. I think you can see where I'm going with that, because it turned out that the orange pill container for my heart medicine fits right over the cap. And so there we have a completely insulated capacitor. The wires can come out through the top here where I drilled the holes for it. And this is, because this is a long cap and the pill case isn't as long, here's your clear tape. This black tape is simply so that the capacitor will be very tight in the cup that screws to the chassis. So here is the capacitor and the way it's going to go in. Now, I've already built the second capacitor with the wiring, and here it is. And because this is a shorter capacitor, it's a little different. The pill case very conveniently snaps over the clear bottom piece. And again, we have that O-ring and the insulating tape here. And so this one's going to sit up here, and this one's going to sit down here like that. And this is out of the way of the amplifier board and the connection points. And it looks kind of cool with the orange. And the wiring will go right into the board like this. Now, I'm using white lamp cord, and the lamp cord is rated at 350 volts. And the original capacitors were rated at 350 volts. These are rated at 450. And so this is my ground, or a common negative. And these are the two positives. I didn't have black cord for positives, so I used brown. And I don't know if you can tell, but it's got, the way I mounted it, we'll pull it out here. As you can see, the way it's mounted into the capacitor is because there are very large tabs on it. I wrapped the cord around the contacts, soldered it really well, made a good mechanical connection, and then put heat shrink tubing on it to hold it all together. Here we see the two plastic cups for the capacitors and the screws that are bolted to the chassis underneath, and they're not going anywhere. And the way this works is very simple. This sits in here. I haven't pushed it all the way down yet. and this one sits right here. Here are the two capacitors. Here's the 40 microfarad capacitor, and the brown and white leads lead over here to the board where the original capacitor was. And these extra two white wires here are because of the way they made it. The original capacitor had three ground plugs on it, so I had to jump from one ground to the other ground to complete the circuits. The same thing happened with the 20 microfarad capacitor here, and it leads over to this section. And I wrote 40 for 40 microfarads and 20 for 20 microfarads, and I put the plus and the minus signs on the board so that it is obvious where they go. And then just to try and keep it neat, which is almost impossible considering all the wiring in this machine, I wrapped it with just some green bell wire. And the same thing here and the same thing here. And that's to keep the wires from flopping around inside the machine and touching the very hot tubes that are in the machine.